Hey there. Is anybody there? I have no idea what's going on right now. I'm sending out invites. I got Diana manning the boards here. Could you, if you're in the chat room now and you could see this, please chime in. This says I have zero viewers, so I guess nobody can see this. Do I need to make a new one? Is this what's going on?
Starting, yay.
So it is starting.
Here you go, six viewers. All right.
So it's starting here.
We're still by ourselves.
All right, here. I was still by ourselves, but let's see if this helps.
Yes, guys. I know you see us, but we're all by ourselves, and
all
there's no fun.
By ourselves.
Nobody wants us.
Trying to get Brodie on, Krista on. James Earl is in the middle of surgery. All right, babe, I'm just, you know, can I get the show set up here?
Yeah, I just...
Thanks, babe, before you're worried about your angle here.
That wasn't my angle. It was like half of me.
That's enough for everybody else. Half for you, Brodie. Mm-hmm. Oh, come on. Can you talk so a little bit?
Yes, I Thanks. Will entertain people. I have some questions for Brodie that I have all lined up.
Cool. What's going on in the chat room, Diana?
In the chat room, everybody's just saying that they could see us.
Can you hear us? That's cool. So we're live. Just nobody can get an invitation to join us. That's really awesome. Press copy. Let's see if this works. If I send this.
Justin's usually good with computers, but it must not be something that is in your control.
Thanks.
See, people can't wait to see more of me.
You're awesome. I would love you to talk more, but...
This is not my forte. If you ask me to teach people something.
Teach people something.
I've been learning a lot about President Lincoln. I've been teaching my kids.
Go. I just thank you guys so much for putting up with this. I hate that. This is so non-professional, and you should punch me in the teeth. Okay, go ahead. I'll keep sending out invites.
Okay. So I've been teaching my kids about President Lincoln's first inaugural address, and I've been learning a lot, and they think that I know everything, but I think it's pretty cool that I teach them. Let's see. Here you go, Justin. Tyler says, no wonder you weren't on the social media season.
Oh, great. Just what I need. Freaking Tyler Oakley, God amongst the social media, telling me I'm terrible at it. Thanks.
It's all right. We're working on it. He's going to start.
No, I'm going to cry. I'm definitely going to cry right now.
Breathe in and breathe out, Justin. And through your nose and out through your mouth. Arrow Man asked how many students I have in a class. I have about... I teach 5 classes of about 25 kids. So I have about 125, 130 students.
That's awesome.
And I know a lot about every single one of them. It's one of the things I'm most proud about. I take the time to know my kids.
All right. I'm going to send Brodie a Twitter message with a link. Let's try this link. Boom. Can you get in? I don't know. If that works, then I'll send it to Krista.
Teach 6th grade reading, so I teach them how to read text and understand it and answer questions about it and think deeper about it. It's not the most fun subject to teach, but I think because my kids...
Boom!
Hey, boom!
That's how you Google Hangout.
Wow, the invitations didn't work that well.
I've never actually gotten this to work successfully, so that was actually really quick timing by you guys to get that to work.
Well, all right. Awesome. All right, Krista, check your Facebook. I just sent you the same thing I sent him on Facebook. Well, Brodie Smith, thank you so much for joining us and for putting up with us.
No problem.
We got a lot of questions for you. And
yes.
I hear that you have a lot to say. I mean.
Well, I think this was a good episode.
I think it was great, too.
I think it was a good episode, for sure. And maybe some stuff to say about prior episodes, too.
Why don't you start with those prior episodes while we try to get Krista on?
Oh, man. Okay. My memory is awful, by the way. So if you have any questions about prior episodes, chime in. But I did want to mention, and I believe it was the second episode in Cartagena, when we did the tent building, the pop-up, I believe it was. Mm-hmm. We actually did what Darius, the Vine Brothers, did, but they didn't show it. We actually showed up to the beach without having the clue.
Oh.
And we actually, because the other problem too is driving down that road, we saw the, what was the weird, I can't even think of the name of it. Blair and her dad's, I'm blanking on the name. They had to do
the task?
Oh, their speed bump.
Yeah, exactly. Their speed bump. And I saw that board from a distance, and it wasn't the initial, like, it wasn't the original speed bump board. And so I was like, dude, there's the clue. Let's go. Because what ended up happening is we got to the juice stand, I think, before they were ready for us. And so the camera was, like, filming, like, B-roll stuff. And I'm like, dude, I think this is where the task is going to, like, I think this is where we're going to have to end up going, because there were still arrows. So that was, like, a 30-minute, like,
mistake.
30 minutes of us just driving around for no reason. So that was a little bit frustrating.
Yay, they didn't show that.
Wow, Krista, welcome.
Hi. I have, like, serious anxiety right now from all that, Justin.
Listen, I've been getting texts from you, tweets from him, Facebook messages, so I'm going through three different things.
And I can't help it all.
I'm a perfectionist at, like, 7:45. I'm, like, ready to go. I'm sweating.
All right. The gang is here. James Earl will be joining us later, but let's kick this off officially. Season 28, Episode 5 recap is going to be on hold because we got special guests from one of the Frizz Bros.
The Frizz Bros.
The trickster himself, Brodie Smith. Thank you so much for joining us. And you were explaining about previous episodes before Krista joined us. So you can jump right back in.
Yeah. So I just want to say, oh, go, Krista. Sorry.
No, they actually, I mentioned that in one of our podcasts because they showed that in an extra clip over ours. Yeah. So I was like,
It was really awkward because it was one of those times where Phil's, like, on the race being like, and now, Brodie and Kurt, what are they going to decide? And he was like, wait, they don't have the clue? And, like, we were like, what?
Oh, yeah, they're
like,
yeah.
So
that's why he did it in the middle of the pack. All of a sudden, Phil, like, came in the middle. He never does that, so that makes sense.
That's why. And they had, like, our taxi, like, turn around to get, like, a good shot and, like, all this, like, extra time, and then we didn't have the clue, so we felt like idiots, but.
Wow. It happens.
Yeah, but it happens to the best of us. It definitely happens to the best of us.
Yeah.
All right, Brodie, I have a question. What did you do to prepare? What did you do to prepare? Like, did you practice reading maps, drive stick shift?
I mean, my most important thing I did was did as much physical therapy as I could on my knee because I tore my ACL in April, had surgery in May, and then walking around New York, I slipped on a cup. And this is like 3 months. It was just a plastic cup for some reason. I don't know. I wasn't looking. The problem was, honestly, I was texting at the time, honestly.
I'm dead.
So my phone got the best of me, but I slipped on a cup and, like, straight-legged my right knee and ended up tearing my meniscus. And then I had to go into surgery again. And it was actually funny because I got, like, a freak out call from the Amazing Race people being like, so, yeah, we just saw on your Instagram you're in surgery again for your knee, like, a couple months before we start. Like, are you guys going to be able to – are you going to be able to do this? So, that was my most important thing is, like, being able to, like, walk and not, like, wake up and not doing, you know, physical stuff.
It's crazy the parallels between you being the orange team, like almost Team Texas-like, and the green team versus us. You having, like, leg issues.
And they're orange.
First and second place. You're orange, they're green. Do you see the parallels?
Yeah, it was definitely something I think we started picking up throughout the race of, like, having this little 1-2 battle. Even though yours guys kind of was, you know,
later. I don't know.
Later on, but yeah, we definitely picked that up. But Tyler and Corey are so cool, so it wasn't like, I don't know, it was weird. We were just kind of all vibing, I guess, at the beginning of the race, you know?
It wasn't so much a rivalry like Justin and Texas. Like, you guys are like a friendly rivalry. It's not cutthroat.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely was an interesting season because we all kind of knew, I knew a lot of the people already. I think a lot of people didn't really know who we were, but it was one of those things where a lot of people already kind of knew of each other, and so it wasn't like, oh, let's just backstab these people. It was more like, no, I actually am a fan of this guy, or like, we like these people. So it was a weird dynamic for sure.
Do you think that makes it harder for you during the race to want to win and have like that competition because you know someone? Because I know for me, say I ever went back on All Stars and I was competing with like Justin or James Earl, like I feel like it's kind of, that's different. It's a whole different dynamic.
So you have like a little bit of loyalty to them kind of thing.
It, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was a little different for me and Kurt because we definitely come from a very competitive background. And like me and Kurt became friends on the Ultimate Frisbee team competing. And that's like, that's basically our relationship is just competing. But I think this season adds in a little bit dynamic, which I think you guys have all seen, of like everyone's kind of really friendly. And then I think, honestly, no one's going to really say it, but I think there is also this like, I don't want to piss off this person's million fans. I don't want to piss off this person. You know, I think there's a little bit. I mean, I think a lot of the friendships and stuff are genuine for sure because we're all hanging out. We all continue to talk and text each other.
Yeah, absolutely.
But I think at the beginning there definitely was this like, okay, let's not piss off anyone. I know for me and Kurt for sure, we just knew that we would maybe get a target on our back early on. And so our goal, kind of going back a couple episodes too, about me giving the answer to Bernie and Ashley and to Matt and Dana, like our goal the entire time, like this first couple episodes, is let's try to make everyone really like us. So that way they won't hurt us later on. That was kind of our mindset.
That explains nobody using the U-turn.
Yeah, especially the double blind U-turn. I mean, that's sick. It's a double blind U-turn.
Clearly people didn't know.
Yeah. Was there any rivalry in the beginning for you? Did you guys look around and say, hey, we got this, we're like the biggest and the best in shape, or did you look at anybody?
I mean, Kurt wasn't actually that big of a, like, he hadn't watched The Amazing Race that much. He knew of the show when I, you know, asked him to be my partner. But we started watching a lot of episodes. I know he was starting to watch episodes on his own. I started from season one. It was like my family show growing up, that and Survivor. And so I was very familiar with the show. And I knew that the team that you look at on paper is not necessarily the team that wins, ever, really. Mm-hmm. There's so much things that can happen. And so me and Kurt, I made sure, like, dude, you can't just say, like, oh, we got this in the bag. We'll crush this team, because you never know what could happen. And so we looked at every team as a threat. Now, obviously, at this point in the season, obviously Tyler and Corey is the biggest threat to beat us because they have been so consistent no matter what. Like, whether it's physical, mental, whatever it is, they have been, you know, right there with us, and if not better than us on some of these legs. So we knew that they were our biggest threat, but like anyone could beat us. Anyone, like we have one bag taxi, we mess, you know, we don't read the clue exactly. Any of these teams can beat us because, I don't know, just on the race, it was kind of a scary thought that like all these people have traveled, all these people are very smart. It's like no one was really out of their comfort zone. And mm-hmm. I think sometimes in the watching these previous episodes, some people you can tell like with cameras in their face and stuff like that, they freak out a little bit. And everyone here was very comfortable with the cameras. So I don't know, it was a tough season for sure.
All right, we're going to jump around and ask you questions about this episode here because there is a lot of things we need to
know. Yes.
I had a quick question. Did you know that this wasn't Frozen, and this is The Amazing Race? You were trying to build a snowman.
he's like Olaf over here.
Wait, where was I trying to build a snowman?
When you got all your snow gear, it might have been in the extra footage. In the extra footage, I think it was. Yeah. You were putting on the gear and you were trying on everything and you're like, oh, I hope we build a snowman.
I think we're gonna build a snowman.
I'm like, wait a second. I know it looks like Frozen, but it's not Frozen. You are on The Amazing Race. Snowman building is not
a
challenge.
Build a snowman.
I think, unfortunately, I wish they actually showed my guesses because I think there's always this person on every season that like tries to guess what you're gonna do. I know Justin, that was you, and I know they showed some of yours throughout the season. But literally, I would drive Kurt mad because on the drive, I'd be like, dude, I think we might be doing this. Like, if we're doing this, you need it. Like, I was always analyzing and thinking, like, if we get here, this is what's going to happen. This is what's, you know, and I was literally wrong every single time. I was never right.
You always think you know what you're going to walk into, and then when you read the clue or something, then it's completely the opposite of what you think every single time. Like, you can prepare as much as you want and overanalyze, but once you get there, you just don't know.
Exactly. Now, is there anything that you want to comment, any comments that you want to make on Brodie before we move on from that topic?
Oh, yeah. I wanted to ask because Blair is in the chat right now, so you guys are friends now, though, right?
Yeah, of course.
Do you have a girlfriend?
Yes.
Oh.
Well, if you follow him on Snapchat, it's pretty simple to see. But you also should check out, he put out a new video today, and you should definitely check that out. Are you going to steal his glory before you go? Before he goes?
No. Well, this is my job. I'm the girl. So, like, how is it? Is it weird to watch back with your girlfriend when it's that?
No, not really. I mean, we kind of had a conversation, and we were smart that, you know, we wanted this, the main focus of us being there to be the race, and so we never wanted to jeopardize that, and so I think we did a good job of that, of, like, keeping the focus on the race. That's why we were both there, and so I don't think, you know, even when you watch back the episodes, they don't really have anything to show, because there wasn't really anything there. But, I think we did. I think we did a good job, and, yeah.
All right.
We had to get your side, because we got one side, so it was only fair.
Tyler wants you to keep your relationship hush-hush still, though.
Ooh.
I feel like I'm doing a decent job. I'm not saying anything.
You guys
just blatantly asked the question. I'm not gonna lie.
Sorry for setting you up for that, bro. It wasn't the bro, man. It wasn't the bro.
I feel you, man.
You're a girl.
All right, now seriously, when you were on that mountain and you were running and you fell on your face and then you asked, "Are we doing it?" Did you really think that you were doing it right at that point when you were face deep in the snow?
So again, my memory is like terrible, but I want to say that I might have said that prior to, because what happens if you watch our shoot, well, first off, when Corey was coming up, my guy had already set up his shoot. So basically, I've never done paragliding before, but you set up your shoot on the ground and then you start running. And if you saw, like, when I started running, I was already, like, deep into the snow and way off the cliff. And a lot of the other people started on top. The reason for that was he set it up incorrectly, unfortunately. And so when we took our first, like, 10 steps, instead of the chute going up in the air like it's supposed to, it flipped because he set it up upside down. And so I didn't want to be that guy. But in my head, I was like, I wanted to kind of be like, dude, can we just, like, go back up and, like, restart? But I didn't want to be, like, the guy, like, oh, look at Brodie trying to be the expert. Like, I have no idea what I'm talking about. Right. I just didn't feel really comfortable starting where we were. So, anyways, when you see us take off, like, the chute, like, goes in front of us. And so we basically Superman for a little bit off the snow. And so I think that's when I said, are we doing it? Thinking, like,
Superman.
And then all of a sudden, it's just face, snow to the face, and we slid. We slid down. Like, I know Erin fell three times, but luckily for her, all her falls were kind of high. We were, like, down the mountain.
Yeah, I saw.
And I was just like, oh, my gosh. I'm glad they didn't really show any of my GoPro footage on the way back up, because I was not the nicest person in the world.
Yeah. Oh, no. Well, we all are sometimes.
All right. Now, is that the reason that you looked actually pissed when you ran up behind Tyler and Corey at the finish line? Because there was a quick shot to your face, and as much as you smile on the show, that was not there. There was like a...
Yeah, I mean, it was one of those things where, again, it was one of those episodes, if you watch, there's really no way of passing anyone, right? If we're in first and they're in second and we don't make a mistake, no one can pass. Because on the traversing, you can't pass someone on there. If you had someone in front of you, even though me and Kurt got up there before everyone else and we had, like, I think 3 minutes a head start, because we actually didn't see Tyler and Corey when we were on there. We were already off the traversing by the time they started, I believe.
Wow.
But you couldn't pass anyone. So if you know, Bernie and Ashley, they picked the camping because they kind of knew that that was the only way they were going to actually be able to pass someone. Uh-huh. And then the gondola situation, like only two teams could go up at once.
Right. So that was supposed to cause separation. I mean, that was the point of it, to cause a little separation with some teams.
Yeah, it caused some separation. Also, like when we got done traversing, the gondola person wouldn't take us down initially. I was pretty livid about that. They like were trying to wait for, I think, Tyler and Corey to come so we would go down together. And I was like, no, we're going now because there's only one gondola. So there was really, honestly, there was no time. All the drivers knew where they were going.
That's what I was going to ask, yeah, too, about that, because it wasn't so it kind of was like there was no separation, like a taxi getting lost, there was nothing like that could have happened, so it was like you had that parked car. And also, how far away were those cars with the license
not
plate?
Far.
I
think we found ours in literally 15 seconds.
Really? And then how far were the other ones apart?
From what I heard from other people, I'd never, like, they kind of made it seem like people were searching around the whole city. I think everything was pretty close. Mm-hmm. Honestly, if you were last and only had to find one car, you might have been looking around, like, the couple streets right next to where we started. But it wasn't like, this car is a mile away.
Do you know why they did that with the marked cars for this episode? Was there a reason? Because it kind of, like, I like taxi element of it.
Well, that's what somebody asked. Like, why don't they trust the racers enough to drive how far it was? Well,
this was snow and ice. I don't think this is
right. So I was going to say there was no taxis there. I think literally I might have saw 15 people my entire time in that city. Like, there was no one in – it was like a dead city. There was no one there. And then also, like, it was very, very bad conditions because – talking to the paragliders, I think that's one of the reasons why so many people fell is because it had snowed so much the days before that I don't think they were expecting that much powder on the snow, because before they said like there was like no snow up there. It was like pretty easy just to run down. So I think the conditions got really bad, and so I think just having a driver used to being able to drive around those areas, you know, to make sure no one flew off a cliff was probably a safe production move there.
I get it. But we need more taxis coming up. I'm over that. I'm over the Mark stuff. I don't know
how much I can say, but I can tell you that a crazy taxi is in the future for sure.
All right. That's it. Don't say anything else.
and I also have insider information that there is a self-drive during this season, so we will see it. I know we will. We will be driving.
Are we allowed to say that?
I just did.
He can do whatever he wants.
What are you going to do?
Like, yeah, you run the biggest podcast for Amazing Race Weekend. Do whatever you want, man.
Bertram is calling. Hold on.
One second.
Hold on.
Do you remember when I yelled at Bertram?
I retract my former statement.
The feet just immediately cuts off.
I yelled at him.
Yeah. Krista was the only one on our season that really gave it to Bertram. She was
Shut up!
He loves me.
Wow.
Damn. He loves me. It's fine.
All right, bro. Is there anything that you want to clear up right here, right now? This is your platform.
This is it.
What do you need to say, man?
The world is waiting.
We know your instructor screwed up.
No, I mean, I think it was good. And like I said, like Tyler and Corey, they were right there behind us the entire time. They didn't show – one thing they didn't show of the race was the dynamite. They made it seem like the dynamite was super easy to find. I can't remember what team it was, but I know one team, if you saw all those stairs that Bernie and Ashley had to walk down to build the tent, I think one team walked down – I'm not sure all of them, but walked down some of them looking for the dynamite. And also the lunch clue, that was confusing to a lot of us. A lot of us were going around looking for, like, this lunch thing when, in fact, the baguette was the thing the entire time. So.
Oh, man.
I thought it was Italian bread. No one else thought that?
No, that's a baguette. That's a French baguette.
That's Italian bread. They're kidding.
No, okay, you didn't. Yeah.
You're a professional athlete. What the conditions? Well, I mean, the breathing conditions. How nice crazy was it?
Um,
was it really hard to breathe, or was it just because there was so much up and down?
Yeah, Dana looked like, was she having a panic attack because she was nervous, or was it the altitude that was so high and she couldn't breathe?
I mean, the altitude, I'm sure, played a role for sure. Yeah. I think maybe if you did have a fear of heights or a little bit of that, like, I could slip off this mountain and die moment, that probably also escalated.
That always does it.
That's a small thing, though. For us, the biggest thing was we were tied to a rope, and so Kurt was in front of me initially, and so that one time that you saw me, like, collide into him is, like, if you go too far, you're pulling the other person. If they're not ready to get, like, to take that step, because I know a lot of teams were having issues with, like, getting pulled by the person in front, so.
Oh, wow.
The altitude, I mean, I was glad to be on that gondola, I can tell you that much, because it was a little bit of a huffing and puffing, a lot of stairs. They didn't show how high those stairs were.
Yeah, they never do. They never show the stairs, man. So many stairs. They just think you get up there. We know. Don't worry.
All right. Anybody got any questions for Brodie before we let him go and get on with the recaps? Or Brodie, is there anything you want to clear up? It's just the time.
No, you guys are doing, I just want to say you guys are doing a good job, though. It's a lot of fun to watch. I look forward to your recaps every week. And I think they will keep getting better and better when the episodes get a little more freakier and freakier.
Well, I hear...
We're only doing freaky stuff tonight on the recap.
I'm trying to keep a positive environment. There's always negative things you can point out, but there's always positive things to point out, and a lot of people.
Oh, for sure.
We will always be fair here, but we will also be honest. So there are times we can't be. We can't.
So that's why I had to ask about, you know, the girl situation. Sorry.
Yeah, no. Ask away. It's all good. No worries.
And we really appreciate this season 28 cast, like, supporting us and chiming in. It really means a lot.
It's always helpful.
You guys do a great job. So.
Thank you very much.
Because we know what it's like. So
we know.
Brodie, tell people where to find your new stuff.
You can follow me on Twitter. How about that? BrodieSmith21.
All right.
If you're really feeling it.
If you want to do some freaky stuff.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about that. But yes.
You guys are bad.
All right. Brodie Smith, one half of Team Frizz Bros. Tell Kurt we said what's up. And you guys keep kicking ass, man. You're really doing a good job.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. Kurt I want a salsa with him.
Dude, he's so good.
Ooh, ridiculous. So good.
He's so good.
I want to watch that.
You have to see him. He wants to take one of my dance classes, and he told me he's going to teach me a salsa.
Dude, do it for sure. Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for having me. I appreciate
it. Good night.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. See you guys.
Bye.
That was cool. All right, I'm glad everything is all situated. James Earl is on his way home, so he'll be joining in as soon as we get here.
Probably driving like a madman to get here.
Season 28.
Scrubs. Sorry. I didn't mean to ruin your...
No, that's okay. Season 28, episode 5 recap. My name is Justin.
No, Diana. Sorry, I was speaking to you.
She's zoned out. And Krista.
That's right, from the cheerleaders and James Earl. Will be joining us in a second, but this episode starts off with a full recap, which I love, a full intro, which they're still getting, of course.
Can I say something about that? I was so upset. Our intro stopped when? How many legs?
I think four.
Like the fourth leg.
I was so jealous when they had the full intro. That's like the best part of the show.
It is, I know.
Especially for you guys. You guys had the damn hair flip.
I know. Come on. Whatever.
It's okay. I mean, so we start in this beautiful Chamonix, France. I mean, this has got to be one of the most beautiful places that the race has ever been.
I said it looked like Frozen. It's like,
yeah, Elsa was there.
Definitely was. One of the legs that I'm very jealous of, actually, and I would really want to be a part of this leg. And also something I was kind of jealous of, I can't lie, is they start the leg with a big pile of free stuff.
Oh my God, I wrote that down too. Jealous of the snowsuits.
And they got sunglasses, they got boots, they got survivor buffs.
There was accessories involved.
Like, I know, sunglasses.
I was really, really.
I don't know that I would have liked all the winter gear though.
I'm not a winter person,
so
I would have loved to do this, but I'm glad that we had the heat season.
Yeah, me too. I agree with that.
Are your headphones in? Because I still hear us in the background. So I'm just asking. I don't know if they're
me
in all the way. Yeah.
Well, they have really big earrings on.
So it's causing the echo.
I bought these earrings for the recap when I got my eyebrows done for the recap. You gotta do what you gotta do. We're getting views now.
All right, so Brody's pants are too tight, and Kyla notices that ass. And that, he definitely takes advantage of the opportunities to get those one-liners in. I appreciate that about Tyler. As we move on, 10:46, the first team takes off, search the streets to find a car with matching license plates, and take that to Le Grand Monte Gondola Station on Mount Blanc.
Yeah. Something like that, that the looking for the car only took like 15 seconds. That's so frustrating.
Yeah, like, I know. That's why I wanted
why
to ask.
Why couldn't it be in a square mile? I mean, at least make it difficult. Make it challenging.
The reasoning for that. Maybe because someone's going to fall or get hurt. Well, they had to keep it close. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe they had to keep it close because that, you know, like they were allowed on the gondola before it even technically opened, and they were trying to keep it.
Yeah, but this was an opportunity for have eight teams that are bunched up.
No, well,
give them a chance to spread out.
Exactly. And that started, that literally finished minutes apart on the pit stop the leg before to really allow people to shuffle it up and to move.
And not only were they close to them, they weren't even spread out. They were all kind of in the same section, he said. So that was a little, that's kind of like a no chance for somebody to get ahead with that. But
yeah. And so that was a little disappointing while watching that, because that was a chance to do something that could have changed the whole course of the race. Now, I got excited. I saw the clue, and I think a lot of us got excited. It was like, oh my God, are they going to go to this car and then get in the car and do a self drive? No. They go to the car and they get in, and the guy drives them to where they need to be.
Yeah. All they said was gondola. He was like, okay.
Yeah.
Speaking of gondolas, I have to just say, my mom, she always calls them gondolas. So
cute. Well, you're Italian, so that's how you get the gondola, like in Italy.
I don't know, but she calls them gondolas. Oh, I'm gonna go on a gondola ride. I'm like, Mom, you mean gondola ride?
That's an Italian thing.
Gondola.
But it didn't happen. And as they're in the cars, Tyler and Corey talk about staying on top and about being in one and two and having that confidence. Kurt and Brody talk about limiting their mistakes. And we get to the route info. It's Mount Blanc, the highest mountain in Central Europe. They must ascend 11,000 feet. So they have to choose a guide, and grab some gear and a baguette, and head up.
Anybody watch Jeopardy? This was the final Jeopardy question. I think it was on Wednesday.
No way. Was it?
Yes, it was. The answer was Mont Blanc.
Mont Blanc.
And I was oh my gosh. Because it said something about the city.
Chamonix.
Yeah. I was like, oh my God, that's where the week before they finished the pit stop, and then it said Mount Blanc, and then that was where they went on Friday, if anybody saw that.
Mm-hmm. And this is when Tyler and Corey take advantage of the situation and choose the hottest guy in all of Chamonix, France to take
it. Yeah, he was cute. The other one's not so much, but that one was cute. I would have chose him.
would that have been a factor in our choosing?
I mean, if given the option, if I'm
Diana, don't.
he doesn't care.
I'm not a jealous guy.
He knows my.
I know
my
she rankings. Ain't going anywhere.
No. Unless it's for Leo, but anyway.
Yeah, I she can go. Hey, if she could get a chance with Leonardo DiCaprio, if you're watching, I know he's a big fan of the recaps. He's one of the creepers in the room.
He loves the peasants.
His name in the room is Michael Jenks. So go hit up Michael Jenks. That's actually Leonardo DiCaprio. Huge fan of the show.
I have dimples, Leo.
She has permission to cheat with Leo. So if you're watching.
All right, guys.
All right, here we go. First gondola ride has Kurt and Brody, Tyler and Corey heading up. And if you've seen the extra bonus footage, Tyler is so short that he almost gets decapitated by Brody's axe.
Wait, how tall is Tyler? How tall are you, Tyler?
He's 5'6", I think.
He's 5'6". And I think...
That's Kurt, giant for me.
Yeah, and I think Brody is like 6'6", or 6'5", so he's like a foot taller than him.
But Corey's very tall.
Yeah, Corey's my height. Yeah, he's like 6'1".
Yeah, I'm 5'5".
Almost 1.
And I love this part of the race because this is the first chance that there is some sort of separation where they allow only two teams to go up at a time with the second group being...
Do you think that they did that on purpose or do you think it was just supposed to be like that?
I think it was logistics. I think because you could only have one team doing the baguette thing at a time. And I don't really think that it allowed for separation because really when you got there, you were in line for the gondola. I was going to say gondola.
Yeah, but gondola. I mean, it's a chance. It's something to give you a couple extra minutes. And those extra minutes always made the difference.
Always. On a couple.
Because it was one gondola. It had to go up and then come all the way back and then go all the way back up. So
Brody is 6'5". Somebody's watching from Croatia where it's 1:30 in the morning. Wow. Oh, Tyler's my height. He's 5'5". He's not 5'6". He's 5'5". Oh, Brody is 6'5".
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, that was, it's, yeah. A, it's the
yeah. He's like Josh's height.
Yeah, this is the tallest cast I think there's ever been on the race.
Yeah, I remember you came home and said everybody is so tall.
Like, I'm used to being a big guy. I was small in that room. Well, anyway, so Bernie says it's his first time that this has ever happened to him, as his baguette doesn't seem to be staying hard. It cracks and crumbles, and they take a chance.
There are so many good jokes.
There's so many.
There
good,
are so many things in there. Like Dana was like, "Our toes are not for sale. We're dancers."
Yeah,
I was like, and then when Blair was trying to give advice to Zach, and he was like, "No, it's not gonna help.
Just pretend it's like my magic."
Yeah, pretend it's like.
He was like, no,
it's
like, that doesn't help.
Doesn't help.
And then they were talking about eating Tyler. They were calling him.
Oh,
Tyler.
Yeah. Oh,
like, that was so much material in those rides up there.
I don't know how they went to Tyler. I'd agree with Tyler. They should cook like Brody. At least
that's what I thought. The biggest one.
Yeah, no, see, I thought they would cook Tyler first because he's the smallest and he would be easy to like overtake.
He's like the little filet and Tyler's.
Brody's
I would go for the bigger.
Size matters in this situation. I have that here. They say they want to cook Corey, but Tyler, because he's so tender.
I have it too, tender Tyler.
and then he goes, "Are you calling me tender?"
I know. There's so many funny things.
I also loved watching Sherry this whole episode, so I am definitely going to fangirl
she's
a little
in the
bit
chat
on
room.
Sherry.
Yes.
Oh, she's here.
Hi, Sherry.
Thank you so much for joining us. Yeah, Sherry is in here, and she starts off the episode saying she wants to do this to prove that she could do this, to show that she's part of this team and she's not being helped. And right from the start of the episode, I believe her. She's crying and she's like nervous, but I believe her. I don't believe she's going to give up. And Blair passes the church. And she takes the opportunity to say, "This is a place we can get married."
He's like, "You got to get your boyfriends in order."
Scott took the chance to throw shade quick.
Yeah, I wrote the quote down. What did he say? Oh, my God. Something really, really funny.
You need to get your boyfriend straight first.
He's like, "Get your boyfriends all squared up."
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and we also see Erin pulling a Krista. Did we notice Erin pulling a Krista?
Oh, my God. That's what I said when I was watching. I was like, this poor girl. I'm like, that's why I'm so happy we did our season, because if there was snow and bombs, can you imagine me? I would have been on the floor the whole season.
That was the second time she wiped out, so she's catching up to you. Oh, I guess she's not. Yeah.
Yeah, well, we're even.
Yeah. Everyone can't believe how high that this thing is going. And then once they get to the first place and they realize that they have to hang upside down like they're in the middle of an action movie and crawl across and grab like a clue off another snow peak. I mean, visually, this was beautiful. Would you either of you have been scared?
I would have been scared.
Definitely. See, the thing is, when I look back at the race now, I'm like, I can't believe I did those things. Would I wake up and do that today? No. But when your adrenaline is just rushing so much, when we did the bungee and things like that, and the microlite, I can't believe I did that. But at the same time, it's like your adrenaline, when you want to win, you just got to go. So yeah. I don't think I would have been scared. It's easier to say, but at the time, like when we did our things, I wasn't, which normally I would be. So it was hard to watch though because it was really, really high up.
Oh,
scary stuff.
There's a lot of viewers here right now, and I looked and there's not a lot of thumbs ups. There's not a lot of shares.
Yeah.
So we're going to take a pause here for our sponsor break, and our sponsor is going to give you a perfect chance to go and thumbs up the video and share it on your Facebook, your Twitter.
That sponsor?
I was going to say, our sponsor is Travelocity. People are asking when we're taking our trips, and we are taking our first trip a week from today.
1 week from today, we're going to Shanghai,
you know,
China.
I lived there for a month and a half.
Yeah. Can you help me get a visa?
Yeah, Justin has to go to New York tomorrow.
I'm trying to get a visa. I'm going to drive up to New York again.
You're going to love Shanghai. I'm so excited for you. And I went to the Bund. Remember, it was on the season with the Chippendales.
That's where we're staying. Yeah.
That's where we're staying. We're staying.
Yeah, we're gonna, so excited for you guys.
All right, guys. You had perfect opportunity to go thumbs up and like that. And I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. All right, back to the episode. Everyone can't believe how high this peak is. And this is when we start to see a lot of fear kicking in. And the big controversy of this episode, I think, that is not talked about enough, Ashley goes across, grabs the clue.
Drops her clue.
And then drops it.
Hmm.
And then all she has to do is go back and get a second one.
Well, do you think that that was planned out ahead of time? Because it looked to me, and what I've heard, that it was the helicopters that were blowing a lot of the winds and why it fell. So I think they kind of were prepared for it. I don't think they were going to consider it a penalty if that happened. But I'm not sure.
No, I didn't.
I just want to chime in. I don't know.
Yeah, if the racers are there, but if it had anything to do with a helicopter or anything above that might have influenced it, then I totally agree, no penalty.
I'm pretty sure that's what happened, but go ahead.
Yeah, if somebody can confirm that in the chat room. But if that's not what happened, I think that this could have been penalty time. I think there could have been a half hour penalty. And I think there's a precedent. I think this was
somebody saying that it was pulled 14? Off the line, she didn't drop it.
Okay.
Oh.
I don't know.
Well, no penalty for Corey's emerald, no penalty for Ashley's clue, Tyler said.
I'm sure Harmstone can remember the last time that there was a penalty for a dropped a clue. All right, Zach is here, and he wants to know why the clue is on a cliff, and then he starts to rethink the whole thing. This is kind of one of the reasons I like Zach, but kind of one of the reasons I'm really worried, because he's not as aggressive, which makes him take a step back and think about things, which can be great. Unless
it can be good because his laid back kind of attitude is working in a way.
But so fear challenges?
Not going to work.
Yeah, not going to work.
Yeah, but he did it. He did it, and he did it without hesitation. So
he did pull through, but that's why I was, you know, he's on my team, so I'm rooting for him, of course. Blair is cheering on Scott. A lot of people, you know, every time she talks, they don't give her the chance anymore. They just feel like it's just grating now. And she screams, Daddy. And I don't know why people think they're a little bugged out by a
It's like a Cole girl saying, Mom!
Yeah,
get over it.
I call my dad, Dad. I'm 40 years old. I call my dad, Dad. And sometimes, yes, when I kiss my dad, I kiss him on the lips sometimes. And I'm 40 years old. Get over it.
All right, team mine.
Yeah, I love him. I say goodnight. I say I love you. You know, like, hey.
Can we talk about, though, like how fast Scott did it? So everyone who keeps saying that they are like a weak team, everything else, he flew through that. So
he definitely did.
Props to him. I was impressed.
And I like that Blair was cheering him on. She was, you know, doing exactly what a teammate should do. You did so well, Daddy. And this is, let's talk about Sherry and Cole a little bit. Both of these people got to this area and didn't think either of them could do it. And Cole pretty much said he couldn't do it. And
yeah, he like froze up. You can tell.
I was really surprised at that.
Yeah,
did somebody so go? Did
I. Like, I didn't know he was going to be that frightened. So, I mean, it's just like, what you were probably going to get into, it just, you know, goes to show like the way she stepped up for her son, like even though she was scared, really shows you, you know, what kind of mother she is and how she was willing to just do it. And she's like, you know what, he's done everything, I'm going to do it. And even though she was scared, she was crying. Like, I have to give her so much credit for doing that, because that's what a mom does. You know, she was like worried about her baby and she's like, I'm just going to do it. I'm going to hang off a cliff for my child. And
it was like mama bear protecting
mama bear.
And I'm gonna call this the super mom move of the episode, because what people don't realize is, because she did this and she showed that she could push through her fears, later in the episode when she comes and she actually makes the super fan move of the episode is when she talks Cole into taking the correct task.
And I wrote that down too.
I don't think Cole would have taken that correct task had mom not stepped up and shown him how to overcome his fears.
Exactly.
So she was a perfect teammate in that situation.
She did it again. That was the smartest move she could have made. She was like, you know what? We just have to do it. Even though she was scared, she pushed him. And if they would have went to that other detour, I think they would have been in big trouble. So way to go, Sherry.
And I love that Cole was sitting there crying the whole time, just watching, because he was scared for his mom and he cared.
Yeah, but I know. I think he was crying because then he was like more like so proud. And Sherry said like he did freeze up, that he's really, really, really scared of heights. So
that's hard for, if you're scared of heights, that's
you
a
freeze.
Really
yeah.
Yeah. All right, now we come to the detour. Dynamite or campsite? Well, dynamite, you had to deliver explosives and lunch and wait for an avalanche, and then you can move on and get into your next clue.
This is really cool.
Or campsite, properly pitch a tent to receive your next clue. This one, in the fun factor, 100% looking at dynamite, wow, holy cow, I want to do that.
Like, I know, me too. I would have picked that.
without hesitation, yeah. I would have been like, hell yeah, I want to do that. I don't care what it takes.
I would have just saw the word dynamite and been like, we're doing it. I don't care what it is.
Yeah, 100%. Diana, you agree? Or
what? We dynamite? Picked dynamite? Yeah, so hands down. All right.
And then looking at campsite, yeah. I was like, I shovel enough snow in New York, honey. I am not doing this. Not today. Well,
now, I understand Bernie and Ashley's reasoning for this. They were like, you know what? We don't think we're going to come in last, and I think this is the chance for us to get ahead and get from fourth place where they are middle of the packish to get that chance to get to first place. Now, I'm cool with them taking a chance because they said it fit into their skill set. They've set up dozens of tents in the past. So they took the calculated risk on a skill set that they had, and I'm okay with that. It turned out to be a terrible idea.
Yeah.
I'm okay with the strategy.
I liked that they did it. It's one of the things I have written down for them. I like that they took the chance to kind of break out of the pack. It's either going to work completely in your favor or not, and that's a risk that you have to take. Unfortunately, it didn't, but I give them a lot of credit for kind of like stepping away from the pack and doing that. So good for them, because I don't know if I would have been able to do that.
They also made one of the critical Amazing Race errors when you say, like, hey, we've done this dozens of times. This should be pretty easy. Cut to right. Boom! Oh, it broke. What do we do?
I say that all the time. Like, whenever we watch cooking shows or shows, they're like, oh, my favorite, you know, like my signature dish is this, and they bomb it. It's all the time. It's foreshadowing. I try to teach it to my kids.
This is definitely a place you could teach foreshadowing to.
Wait, anyone. Guys, did we miss the lunch thing?
Oh, no, we're going back to Dynamite now.
Okay. We got to talk about the lunch.
I figured campsite, there's only one team. We could do that and get it over with. Now, over at Dynamite, we see Kurt and Brodie, struggling with the rope link between them. They can't get into the right rhythm. Dana and Matt can't find a dynamite, and Dana flips out a little bit and has to pull her stuff down. And is it panic attack, you think?
Yeah. Panic attack.
I think that I have really, really bad anxiety. And I think that being up there, and I think the altitude having to do with it, and then all that stuff on you, it's really overwhelming. And she looked like she
could have been.
Hello.
Yay, my love. Hi. Oh, Elvis just woke up. He got excited.
Oh, I guess he did, because I'm here now.
All right, James Earl, we're just getting into the detour. We talked about campsite with Bernie and Ashley, and we're just starting to talk about dynamite.
Dynamite.
We're up to the part where Dana flips out a little bit and has a panic attack from what Krista and Diana have both experienced panic attacks in the past. So,
that's what you're describing. That sounds most consistent with a panic attack. Yeah, that's right.
And the doctor.
Medical terms.
I forgot we have a doctor in the room.
Very consistent with panic attack, racing heartbeat.
Sorry, I just came from work.
We could tell.
I love your dedication, man.
You're the best.
I also, at this point, we see Tyler and Corey do really well, as they always do. And they also tell Matt and Dana where the dynamite is, which is all the way back down that long flight of stairs that she just went up.
Again, it's one of those times to help a team when it doesn't. Like,
hurt you.
Yeah,
it won't hurt you as bad because you know that they're going to have to go all the way back down and all the way back
up.
Dana, again, is terrified, and Matt seems to be really patient, really supportive with her during this episode, knowing that it's not like her being mean or being an ass. It's that tension building up inside, and she's trying to let it out. So
she was genuinely scared, and it looked like the shoes they had on were not good for the snow. I don't know. I'm not really like into that, but I was reading a lot of things that people that go skiing and climbing, they were saying stuff about the shoes. They're like, they shouldn't be wearing those. They couldn't like grip their feet. So I want to know if the racers, how they felt actually climbing. Is that why they kept falling and stuff like that?
So if the chat room, if you could let us know, that'd be awesome. We also see Tyler genuinely 100% being terrified here, climbing up this mountain and slipping. And I like seeing fear in people. Fear means they care, and fear means there's passion. And in this case, fear was just like a beautiful location, and you could possibly die. And they talked about dying so much this episode.
Also, poor Tyler, if you looked at his glasses at this point,
oh, the fuck?
It looked like okay, it looked like milk was covered them. Like they were like you couldn't see anything.
I know.
Yeah, the key whenever anything's fogging up in your glasses, the key is to uncover your nose for future anything. It's your nose that's fogging up your glasses.
Really?
He reminded me so much of Tiffany in this because he kept saying, I can't do it because my glasses are going to fog up. And every time there was water, she's like, I can't do it because of my contacts. So I was like, aw.
Tyler said he cried on the side of the mountain. And I don't blame him. I would have been crying right there, too. I think I would have reacted like Dana with the, I'm really scared.
Well, oh, hey, about the shoes. Sherry just said those are the shoes that they gave us.
Yeah, so. Yeah, I know that, but I was reading. Someone wrote that the shoes that they gave them weren't proper to be in the snow.
Oh, well, Kurt also said I thought the shoes were sufficient.
Well, okay. This is where the runner-up for Superfan Move of the episode comes in, and where Corey actually pulls a little bit of a Tiffany with a nice little motivational speech to get get Tyler in the right state of mind again. And I think he was real supportive, and that's something that doesn't go noticed as much in the race, but so it means so much to
it
have
does.
To have a supportive partner. It definitely changes the game.
Dana, you know one thing about this episode, this part
yeah,
though,
yeah.
As a viewer, I was getting a little confused about where the racers were, like relative to everyone else, because like the location that they were doing, like the dynamite and like getting up to the place, all looked so similar that I know that I had to watch it like I had to keep rewinding to figure out where people were.
Yeah,
and I don't know if I was the only person that had that issue.
No, it was hard to tell because I don't know how many peaks there were for these people to climb at the same time, or if it was just one and you had to keep waiting and go back. And if that was the case, they were in the same order that they were always in. And I think that was the case from what Brodie said earlier. There was no chance to pass people on this task.
Wait, I'm laughing because Tyler said Kurt gave his sunglasses to Herman. So only racers are going to understand that.
But yeah.
He traded him for some Band-Aids, I bet. He really needed that Band-Aid. And no Band-Aid.
Don't say my name on camera.
Do not say his name on camera.
I don't need
some bold guy busting through that door and grabbing me by the neck in the middle of my podcast.
I can't.
And like rappelling through the window, like kick it out.
No, like... He talks exactly like Arnold Schwarzenegger because they're from the same place, and he's like, I must break you. Like, he's this serious, dude. Like,
he's so scared.
I will say, though, sorry, going back to the dynamite, I'm jumping around. I will say, I think that one looks a little more physical in comparison to the campsite, just because you're having to do a lot of climbing in some very thin air. At least with the campsite, I know there was a lot of digging, but I just don't feel like that's the same as having to, like, climb and balance and shift and all that stuff.
Well, I think that it was a pretty clear that the dynamite was faster on this one.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I'm not saying it wasn't faster. Oh. I'm just saying it was more physical.
Oh, maybe, yeah, because you had to go up and down. And
then you just shovel. And James Earl, I don't know, you're in Alabama. There's
shoveling.
Not much snow there, but shoveling yeah. is, it depends, too, if it's, like, wet snow, heavy snow, and if you're high, shoveling is very physical.
That's what we were talking about before. It's like, I'm from New York. Like, we know shoveling here, it's not... It's
gotcha.
Not fun, and it's
is
not...
Is Blair in the chat?
Yeah, she was.
Okay, well, I have a question for Blair, because here at this point is, like, almost surprised me, because I think this is... I don't know if this was awesome strategy on her part, or if it was just, like...
Oh, the comment?
Yeah, where she sits there, and Scott grabs the dynamite and thinks they need to pick up lunch, but Blair thinks that people eat baguettes for lunch, so she figures it out. But then Aaron and Jocelyn get there and grab it, and she makes a comment to them.
I think that she was really being quirky. I don't know if she was really trying to mess with them. And joking? I don't know. Well, I'm sorry.
I was curious to know if the audio was at that point, because anytime I don't see audio with mouth movements, it's a little
She said, I wish it was strategy, so that's what I figured. It wasn't. She was just, she was just being Blair.
Because right after that, she said, Daddy, do you think I should tell him I was kidding? And then that was I thought it was like, wait, maybe she said, she's like, that's the strategy.
Yeah, I think it was just like her kind of kidding around, and she said it wasn't in the chat. So.
Okay, yeah, so I wound up giving about a 3 to 5 minute head start because the clever girls got lost looking for the lunch.
Yeah, Blair said they edited it and it was different.
Oh, yes. They called it.
Got it.
Kurt wanted to point out how stupid of an idea it was to put the dynamite in the shirt. I was just thinking he was trying to keep it warm. Just keep it close to the heart.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. This is when we see Aaron and Jocelyn scrambling to look for the lunch because Blair threw them off with her evil plot.
That was so funny, and I was reading their tweets, and they said they actually stole Phil's lunch.
Yes.
You can't write that. You can't make that up.
No, you can't. It's in the bonus clips, isn't it?
Yeah, they show her rifling through this big bag, and this is a big bag full of a lot of stuff, and it happens to be Phil's actual lunch. So that would have been awesome if they wound up stealing it and bring it to the top of the mountain.
Phil's like, that's my ham and cheese. Oh,
you have a 30-minute penalty for stealing my lunch.
But Aaron and Jocelyn end up finding the place by accident and then saying, do you guys eat baguettes for lunch? And hand it in, and that's exactly the place that it winds up being. So they find it by accident, and then Sherry and Cole crying their whole way through the whole thing, but they do make their way through it. This has been a tough episode for Sherry and Cole as far as emotion-wise.
Yeah, they were really nervous.
Yeah, I will say, I would give a little credit, though, even through the tears, Sherry did say something smart, I think. She was talking about how long it would take to set up a campsite. Like, just Cole is wanting to do the campsite, that. And Sherry, you already talked about that? I'm sorry.
No, you're right.
Your side of it.
But yeah, Sherry, I think, was smart to keep pushing Cole to do the other side of the detour, and I feel like she was having to do, like, a motherly, gentle push to make it happen, but I think that paid off for him in the end.
Definitely. We were saying, like, there could have possibility of them maybe being eliminated if they did the other one.
I think if they had done the other one, they would have been eliminated.
Yeah, and I'm calling this the superfan move of the episode, where Mother Sherry talks her son into overcoming his fears and pushing through because this is the right decision, and she convinces a kid who's literally brought to tears by his fear to push through. And that's, I mean, you can't ask
so more. So Sherry's the super fan? She got the super fan award?
So Sherry, you got this week's super fan award. So
all right.
Kudos to you. We no need to wait till the episode ends for this one. All right. So we have to route info. We have to take a car to the Pran Paraz gondola station and search for your next
clue. The same car.
And this is where they get the roadblock. Who wants to feel the wind beneath their wings? And this is the best part of the entire episode.
Yes.
If there's this part here is what makes this episode special. What makes the episode go from like to like wow. This last 15 minutes is probably can be up there with some of the best 15 minutes of any Amazing Race ever in my book. And I'll go through why. So the tandem paraglide, who wants to feel the wind beneath their wings? It's a tandem paraglide where you have to look for the Yeti, and he will have something for you to remember. Now, did anybody think this was an actual Yeti? I'm going to say it was a Bigfoot.
Uncle John!
Wait, you said that it was Uncle John in the costume. Do you know I really believed you?
Wait, wasn't? I believe that too.
No,
we just made fun. We don't know.
We're just like, it's probably Uncle John. They're like, yo, John, get in the Yeti costume.
Yeah, I could picture him like, all with his nose. I'll get in the costume.
Go ahead, let's go. All right.
Everybody who's not on the race, Uncle John was like our babysitter. He's like your Uncle John. He's like a short, little, cool, happy guy.
I'm sure Sherry and Tyler, they all know Uncle John.
They know John, Uncle John.
So that was a terrible Yeti costume, a little disappointed. And the Yeti was just waving a French flag.
Yeah, we're going to get to that. I have a lot to say about that, too.
All right.
Yeah, Corey Zach still is that. I once dated a Yeti. That was a good one.
Okay, I think that was the title quote.
That's what I said. No offense, Brodie, but Corey had the episode title. I once dated a Yeti. Really? That was it. That should have been it.
Yeah.
Ooh, Tyler doesn't know Uncle John.
Ooh.
What? Sorry, that was so annoying.
What? Uncle John get fired?
I don't know.
Is John still there?
And, Oh, maybe he's not.
Blair doesn't. Oh,
all right. Blair doesn't.
All right, this is inside joke. This is inside. Nobody knows. We'll find out about it afterwards.
Yeah, we're being annoying. God.
All right, the snow is very deep, and we found out that it just recently snowed there, and there was a lot of fresh powder that they weren't expecting.
Tyler said I met that Yeti that Corey was.
No, the snow looked like it was at least 3 or 4. I mean, they were running like above their knees.
Well, I got inside information from Erin, who gave me the details on what separated everybody on this. She said underneath the snow there was different types of
like platforms. So there was one that was rocks. So you would, if you ran on the rocks, that was cool. But in the other area, there may have been a bush. So you're like walking and there's a bush.
Oh.
So it's, the snow is so deep, you didn't know what was underneath the snow. And everybody, if you watched, everybody that was up towards the top of the hill that ran down that path got off better than everybody that was at the bottom of the hill because it was different footing underneath the snow.
You could tell.
So that made all of the difference. And
yeah, like we were talking about before, and someone just said in the chat that it had snow the day before, so there was probably so much extra snow on top of it that running in that was probably that much harder for them.
Oh, yeah,
and it probably would have been up to here on me.
Yeah, I think that was the trick to the roadblock. I don't think it was so much as spotting the Yeti, because unless the camera was tricking me, like the camera zoomed in at the Yeti at one point and then zoomed back out, and I saw the paths of the people running.
Yeah.
So I think the Yeti was like immediately after the beginning. So I don't think that was really the trick. I think the trick was keeping your knees up and getting taken off.
It definitely made a difference for teams. This was the only part of the race where teams actually had a chance to pass each other. Also, one of the most beautiful settings
with
the sun and the mountains. I mean, in the history of the race, definitely.
Gorgeous. Yeah, I have written down that only Corey, Matt, Blair, Sherry all got it on their first try. Everybody else.
I have something about Sherry on that one. Bless her little legs. I don't know if you watched her when she was going off.
Bless her legs.
But when she's in the air and she's still running. Like, if you go back and watch it, her legs are still moving. And actually, that's what's getting my little seal clap if we're spoiling things, because that made me so happy, because that's how determined she was.
Like, she was like, I'm still in the air and I'm going to keep running while we're in the air.
I love it. I did notice it. For me, it reminded me of like E.T. when they're bicycling and he gets in the air and he's still riding.
Oh, somebody said...
Like a dog above water.
Like if you answered the question incorrectly, what would you have done? Because it's not like you would...
Said we could get the dinner, redo the jump.
Well, this is why I kind of... I wish the roadblock was challenging, obviously the takeoff, but I wish there was something more than with the flag. You know how we had to find the motto or the flag. When we found it, we had to go to Knife's Edge. So I kind of wish that there was maybe something more like leading into it. It wasn't just like, okay, I see the flag. It was kind of really, really obvious.
Well, that's what somebody said. Like, was the question asked, like, what was the flag the Yeti was holding,
what was the
Yeti holding?
No, it was what was the flag that the Yeti was holding.
Yeah, I feel like it should have been a little bit more...
Yeah, a little more difficult.
A little more difficult. But I understand the takeoff was hard and everything else, but maybe, you know, leaning it to somewhere else like we did or something like that.
Yeah,
I think Brodie had a great quote with this roadblock that kind of sums up the race. And, like, I love it because he was like, this is what the Amazing Race is about, doing things you would never do in your entire life. And, like... That just sums up the race in one little sentence, and I loved it.
Well, that's why I called Sherry out, and I think that, like, overcoming your fears and just, like, rising above makes you, like, those are the moments that make you grow on the race, and those are the moments that you can't buy doing anything else.
Sorry for laughing at you, Diana. I was reading Sherry's comment, and she was like, I'm going to keep running until my ass is in my seat.
Sherry said she didn't have a path, that Erin and Ashley did have one, and she didn't, and she got up.
You go, girl. Power through. So on this roadblock, we see Brodie gets there first, and his problem is that he was running up, and he's like, who's so sick? Who's so sick? I want you. Who's so sick? So he grabbed the person.
Baby. Boom.
Yeah, you didn't say who's the best hang glider or who is like relatively my height, which is what I would have looked for, somebody who's my height, so we run at the same pace. But he picked a guy that was really short, and I think that.
But would you have been thinking that at the time, or looking back, you thought that?
Probably. That's how much he was always analyzing every single
thing. So you would have thought that?
They say pick somebody, I'm like, when we had to pick the French rap, I looked around trying to see who I thought spoke the best
English. I did that too, and also with the tango, I did that as well.
Yeah, well, for the tango, I looked at it, I was like, all right, who would I feel most comfortable with?
That's what I said.
Yeah.
I was like, the man.
And for the rap, I didn't get a choice. He just jumped in and picked that one.
Yeah, I just picked the guy who I thought would... Had to speak the
I would have picked white girl probably with like the curly hair.
Yeah, white girls. Can't
rhyme.
White girls can't rhyme.
I disagree.
That's true. Kurt's calling out his partner, saying, "Looking at his GoPro instead of running."
All right.
I'm trying to film.
And so Tyler tells Corey that he can't do this because his glasses will fog up, which I found funny.
Typical Tiffany.
Oh, sorry. Blair said that her dad picked the biggest,
the biggest guy, he wanted to protect me, like while she was doing the paragliding.
Aww.
I
thought,
that's cute.
Good job. That was really smart.
So the snow seems very deep. It's all about the landscape positioning on the mountains. We find out that Matt Stefanina, besides being a freaking world-class dancer...
I did not know this.
...was a competitive snowboarder for 10 years. This kid is talented.
Yeah, seriously.
So he nails the takeoff on his first try. It looked like he was the one that knew how to run through snow better than anybody. It didn't look like he had a problem at all on this challenge. Kurt cheering on... Corey thinking it's Brodie. Oh, right. Okay, so...
He thought it was him first, yeah.
Yes, so off on the mountain, Brodie is up there, and he's first to take off, and from what the insider information that we heard is that his instructor put the parachute upside down, so when they took off, it went straight down. So he lost the chance for his first place, but Corey took advantage of it, powering through like they always do. They get to the tasks, they power through, and they solid and steady. Corey nails it his first try, and cuts to a great scene, which I love. The contestants down on the ground looking up. You can't tell who it is. There's a little drama being built here. Who's going to be in first place? And this is when Tyler goes nuts and Corey screams and we're number one. And it's a very happy moment. I know Diana was going nuts. She I loves was, what her team
Tyler's
did.
Like just, he gets, he does like jumps ups and down. And
and his laugh is just.
I know. Just a piece of it. I just want a piece of it.
I will say, though, how nerve-wracking is it to be the other like person doing the roadblock? Because a lot of the times you can see what's going on. You have somewhat of an idea. These people really had no idea until they were there.
Yeah.
How nerve-wracking is that?
Well, yeah, it was kind of like when we were in Poland and everything was going on in the kitchen area and you were just sitting there waiting and you had no idea what was going on. And when she would come back, you're like, is it right? Like, you had just no clue. That's the worst feeling, just waiting to see if they're going to come back and who is it with the right thing. So
Tyler said, oh my God, Kurt, remember when we thought it was Brodie? And I was like, oh, what a shame if a helicopter snipped the parachute. And then it was Corey.
Kurt goes, I knew there was an issue because I knew who he'd be yelling, and I didn't hear anything, so I knew something was up. That's so great.
But it's a very happy moment for Diana and the green team as they leave out of there, and Kurt is just baffled, wondering how the heck could this happen again, the green team popping ahead of him, as those notorious green teams tend to do. So they're off the mountain, and they do really well.
Yeah, but they win so much more humbly than you.
Yes.
You, I'd say, too.
Yes, because...
You, Justin, not Sam.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm very confident, and when people ask me questions about confident. How I'm feeling, no, I tell them the truth.
They're confident, too.
They're confident, too.
Cocky, I'm confident. There's a difference.
I always just, it's the way you say it.
All right, moving on.
All right, we'll have a therapy session. Therapy sessions live on Tuesdays.
I'll be there. I'll be the mediator.
How cute was Claire when she was coming in for the landing? She's like, Daddy, I did it.
I have that too. I love it so much. I can't even.
Rachel's on the mountain. She fails her first shot, giving Scott and Blair a chance to get ahead. And this is what I love to see. Like, everybody's on the mountain. These are the challenges that I love. You can see the people right there, and you can see them fail, and you can see them succeed, and that's when everybody's tension is rising, and that's when true champions are at their best, and this is when people perform. And as the same all season long, the cream has risen to the top. The same four or five teams have been at the top every single time, and it's not just because they're the first there. It's because
except Scott and Blair, they've sneaked their way up here this time.
And that's what I was going to say. It's like this time right here is... Scott and Blair took advantage of the opportunity.
I do have to say, looking at my draft picks, out of the two of you, I have all three of them.
I kind of hate that I don't have draft picks, but I'm over it.
You can be with me.
Oh, well, you joined. We didn't know you were going to join us permanently. We thought we were just going to have you for one episode.
I know, but, you know.
That season we'll do on everybody.
Okay.
All right, so Rachel fails her first shot, which gives Scott and Blair a chance, and they totally take advantage of it and pull ahead. and finish in the top four for the first time this season, which is so awesome for them. Very happy to see them do it. And at the bottom, we see the partners on the mountain wondering who's in the sky. You see Bernie. He says, I have a feeling that's not Blair, or we would have heard it by now. And, then, and that's the perfect editing into Daddy! Zach is bewildered. He's down there. He can't believe it.
He says, there's my daddy!
I love that. I love that they're that old and they still have that relationship. I mean, every father wants
the time. We talk about it all the time. I don't know how old
she is. She's 21 or 22, isn't she?
Yeah, but that's the time when kids are like on their own.
She's a baby.
Rebelling.
She's 21. I didn't know that. I feel so old.
You? Stop it. I don't even want to talk. She wasn't even born when I graduated high school. So this leaves a great showdown at the top of the mountain, all lined up, waiting for the air to come. You got
this
Ash.
This was my favorite part of the episode, when the three girls were lined up, and that shot, and you're just like that anticipation of waiting and that wind coming. I thought that that was the best part of the episode.
Yes.
I would hate to live that moment, though. Like, bless the three of them, because you know, like, the moment you see one person take off, you're like, crap, should have taken off. Please trip.
And that's what happens.
That's how they felt.
That's how it goes.
They're sitting there waiting. Ashley goes for it. She's like, what the hell? I'm going for it. I'm in position. Boom! Fails. Now she has to climb all the way back to the top. Sherry's instructor whispers in her ear, you got to give it all you got. This is one try. We're going to do it. Sherry's crying and huffing and puffing and runs down the hill and boom! Takes off. And that's like when the crowd goes wild watching the episode.
I love the little leads kicking. The little leads never stopped.
So funny.
I was genuinely excited watching this part of the race. I tweeted about it. I was watching it. I was on the edge of my seat, and I'm like, this is what the race is all about. Coming down to the end, when people who are fighting their fears and overcome it at the perfect time.
And I loved this.
It was so awesome. She nailed it. And then Erin is sitting there like, oh, my God, she has to try. She has to try. Boom, fails again. Ashley sees her. She has a chance. She goes again, but no. That's when we see all the teammates on the ground screaming for their partners in the air, not knowing who's above them. And then Ashley calls back.
This is good narration. Woo.
Right?
And all the teams are coming in.
This is me being excited. This is me, what I was thinking in my head. I had to try to get it out on paper. And then, so Ashley calls back, and then Jocelyn doesn't know what happened at the top of the mountain. And we turn to Erin, and she's trying one more time by herself. Boom, fails again. And this is the time when people would quit. They would need that huge motivational speech to keep going. But she powers through. She gets it on her next try, and she's up in the air crying.
But you can see the emotion. Like, I think all of that built up, like, as she was failing, that the moment she got it, it kind of just released. Oh, adorable puppy. All that just released. And, like, she just enjoyed the moment after that.
I feel like she knew, she was in last, but then just to look around and remember when you have those moments of where you are and experience it, like, those happy tears she was crying, like, I just felt that so much, like, when she was like, this is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen, and I was like, that's what the race is.
Even though she was
in last, like, that's exactly those moments. Yeah, I was getting teared. I'm like, you know that feeling. Like, you just have to take it in every moment that you can.
I'm proud of her for holding all that in and powering through and waiting until she was in the air. Because it would have been really easy to break down, get defeated, and then, like, have the moment before you even get going. But she didn't. And I think that speaks a lot as a racer. The fact that you keep pushing through, even though you know you're in last. And then you can have your release. I'm not one of these people that judge it. Like, I cried on the race three times. I don't remember how much was shown, but, like, I cried.
I cried a few times, too.
Justin cried enough for everybody.
But, like, I don't fault that at all, but she did it at a time that was appropriate. Like, she just did what she pulled it out, even though...
She did it, like, a moment of, like, over, like, just beauty. Just realizing, where she is and what she's seeing and... We did that when we thought we were going home in Brazil, trying to enjoy the helicopter ride. I was trying to take it in, and I know a little piece of what that's like, and it was emotional because of her reaction to it. It was just made me cry.
Yeah, I knew it wasn't just me feeling that excitement when I turned and I looked at Diana, and she's like, oh my God. and I turn, I look at the screen, and Erin is crying, and I'm like, wow, this is real. This is happening. This is what the race is all about. It brings those feelings, and you get invested. And then Jocelyn gives a great little speech, keeping her spirits up, saying, you never know, somebody could have got lost.
Oh, Jocelyn's in. Oh.
And this is one of those times when the team can get down and be bummed.
Oh, hi, Jocelyn.
Hey, thanks for making it. People can get down and bummed and all bummed out, and they kept their spirits high, and they ran to the finish line, and they finished strong, and I got to respect that.
I respect that, too, because I hate when people come to the mat, and they did the coulda, shoulda, woulda the next day, and they keep going on and on and on, and, like, they didn't do that, and that's really important to me, and that sticks out with certain racers when they do that, when they keep the positivity up, even though you got eliminated, so... You know, kudos to them for doing that.
It reminded me so much of when Tiffany was cheering you on in Macau. Like when, as soon as Jocelyn landed, Erin's apologizing, I'm sorry. And she's like, no, you know, there's nothing to apologize for. We could be a keep on racing. You never know it. I mean,
yeah, because you don't ever know. So you just have to, that way.
There is some more stuff that we didn't hear about that we're going to get to. So finishing in first, Tyler and Corey, they win a trip to Boracay Island in the Philippines, which they're going to give to us. Thank you so much. We really appreciate that.
Wait, what? Really?
No.
Oh, I was like, whoa. Like,
we have
no. And I love that Travelocity always throws in a spa package so that we can hear Phil say spa. Whenever he says spa, it's like trending on Twitter for some reason. People love it. And finishing right behind them in the same frame, as we could see, it's Kurt and Brodie. And Brodie looks a little peeved.
Not happy.
Not happy.
He wants to go to the Philippines really bad.
Well, they're ultra competitive. He just wants to win that red leg, and he felt it wasn't his fault. They lost. And finishing up at the top as well is Matt and Dana. And then the surprise team here, Scott and Blair.
They have been moving up. It was
moving
like
up.
8-11, 9-8, 8-4, I think.
That was like me and Tiff, just climbing the ladder. It's okay.
Go ahead. That's my pick.
Start from the bottom, end up at the top.
There it is. And then Zach and Rachel finish. Now, this is where there's a little jumble up. So Sherry and Cole finish, and then Bernie and Ashley are there. And
I would love to know how that played out, because that's the one thing that they didn't show you.
Ding, ding. I got the information from some people that I know at the race. And the big thing was Sherry, her parachute, when she was coming down, they landed on a crew, like a camera crew. Uh-huh. And so they couldn't instantly let go of their chute. They had to, like, get out of the area and, you know, go to a place. So at the when Ashley landed, they immediately got their chute off and just left out, so they were able to pass them over at the mat. So I was like, oh, what happened? So it's those little things you don't get to see, but we get to exclusive information here, and I'm so lucky.
I will say one more thing, too, about Sherry and Cole when they checked in. Yes. And Mom and I can relate to this, and I don't know if you caught this when you were watching it. So he's like, Bernie and Ashley, you're in sixth place. If you look at Sherry and Cole for any other team, they would be like, yeah, we're in seventh place. But they've gotten a penalty, and I could see it on their face. Like, after you get your first penalty, every time you check in, you're like, oh, God, am I really? Yes, okay, I'm in.
Yeah.
I could see it on their face, and I remember feeling that every time after Mom and I had gotten that penalty. So I'm curious to know if that really was the feeling that I saw, because I think that's what it was.
Right, because you're, like, kind of paranoid that every time you check in, like, something's going to happen, you're saying?
Yes, because you have no idea. Like, the first time you get your penalty, you're like, oh, crap, I didn't even know that was going to happen. So, like, every time you check in, you're a little hesitant.
Like, am I really here? Is everything okay?
And then you get the wrenches. Yeah, there we go.
Well, because Phil will say, like, you're the fourth team to arrive.
However,
you're like, oh, my God.
And I have some information as well. In a couple weeks when we're back with the next episode on April 3rd, we will have Sherry on the show to explain all of this and some stuff that we see in the next episode. If you do look at the previews coming up, we see Sherry crying, apologizing. We see her falling in the middle of the street and Cole being worried.
Serious stuff coming up.
So it looks rough.
I need to know what this is all about. So she is going to be joining us. I believe it's April 3rd, which is totally awesome. And next episode, we see some dancing involved, so we know Matt and Dana are going to step their game up. And
I will say, that dance looked super hard because Dana's, like, an amazing dancer. Like, I love just watching them dance, But she kind of looked confused and a little bit of a hot mess.
I saw that. She looked like she was struggling or like she just lost.
That might just be her dance face, you know, how such fierce.
She
was in the zone.
If that's like her dancing, I would love to see like everyone else.
That was my biggest fear, like on the race, was getting a dance challenge and not being able to do it on the first try. I think that's probably like every dancer's fear, so maybe she was just nervous about it.
We see cliff diving. We see Tyler Oakley Eskimo kissing somebody on the race.
That was adorable.
So I don't know. Maybe Tyler found a boyfriend finally. Hey, go for it. And we also see camels versus bikes, which I'm really looking forward to. That looks cool.
It kind of looked like they would have to race the camel and beat the camel or something.
So that looks really cool. All right. Overall thoughts of the episode, Diana. What are you thinking?
I really liked it. I think because it's going to be another 2 weeks before the next episode, I think it was exactly what they needed. A couple people also said that. And I think overall as a season, I'm pretty impressed with it. And even my good friend Susan, who doesn't like anything, is really enjoying the season. So that says a lot. I don't know if you guys knew Susan.
Yeah, Susan Mitchell. Oh, there we go!
Susan that we speak about, like, what is the deal?
We'll
talk about it later.
If she's impressed with the season, then that means that it's a great season.
She was one of our haters. Damn, Susan!
I will say, I think this episode was really good, especially at the end. The end had, like, all of, like, the tension that you needed. I was shocked this was an elimination episode.
Agreed.
Like, I for sure thought it was going to be a non-elimination episode.
I thought it was going to be a continuation.
Mm-mm. So here's my guess, though. Since this one wasn't, I guarantee you next one is. There's no way they're going to save two non-elims for the top six teams.
Yeah, it has to be the next one if it wasn't this one.
It doesn't have to be anything. That's why the race is so amazing. They always keep you guessing.
I don't know. And
they're not going to have a non-elimination before 2 weeks off. You can't do that. That's playing with the emotions too much.
That's true, too. I have the updated little like scores or the averages whenever we want.
Well, I'm going to do my hair flip because you guys did everything. Your stuff already.
Diana didn't put anybody in check. Go ahead. Who's getting the hair flip?
So mine is kind of, I feel like someone that was, I don't know, that I noticed, but mine, hair flip, is going to Ashley. I feel like when she did the zip line the first time, she was faster than any person that did it. I watched her, and she literally did it so quick. Then when the clue drop, she got right back on. She did it again, didn't say a word. Then her doing the other detour and taking that chance and her just being like, okay, we got to make it wider. Let's do it. Like, she was just down for anything. And then also when she fell again at the roadblock, she got right back up and then did it again her second try. So I have to say she kind of flew under the radar, and she was such a warrior in this episode. So I really just want to give her props because I know a lot of people talk about how strong like Bernie is, but that girl is just as strong, and I think she deserves some credit.
Amen. All right.
I agree. Can I tell you also just how much of a girl crush I have on her? I don't know what it is, but I have such a girl crush on Ashley.
Yeah, you're not allowed.
She's trying to claim everybody over here.
Yeah, I just have everybody has to be mine. That's it.
It's mine. She's hoarding people. I overall thought the episode was awesome. I wish there was a couple more opportunities for people to pass people, but I thought the landscape was beautiful. I thought the last 15 minutes of the episode was some of the best 15 minutes of ever.
I thought it was exciting.
In the race.
Yeah.
I loved the excitement. But obviously there are some parts that could have been better. But I really enjoyed this leg. And do you have anybody you want to put
in check? No, I don't have anybody.
Really?
No, it was just such a great episode. There was nobody that did anything that deserved it. Hmm. I mean, if anything, it was more of like seeing really, really good times of teamwork, that people really got along and people really worked well together, that there was no check moments. Sorry.
All right, who do we think is going to be eliminated next? Oh, actually, before we get to that, let's get to some statistics that superfan James Earl has been calculating. He has a supercomputer.
We just need a little sound clip.
All right.
Yeah.
So, like I said, the whole time I'm doing this, I'm including the eliminated teams, because sometimes eliminated teams have better averages.
Okay.
But from bottom to top, coming in 11th place is still Marty and Hayden at 9.5. Unfortunately, they're pretty locked in. They're not going to be able to change their position. Next, Darius and Cameron at 8. They're also not going to be able to change their position. Next is Scott and Blair, who's also tied for 8.
Wow.
Great for them. Their average is going to go up next week no matter what. So they still have room to grow. Sherry and Cole, 7.4. Aaron and Jocelyn, 7.2. Brittany and Jessica, 7. Then we have Zach and Rachel, 5.6. Bernie and Ashley, 4.4. Dana and Matt coming in at 3. Brody and Kurt, 2.2. And Tyler and Corey at 1.6, which I think actually is like the top average right now of ever. Granted, there's a lot of race to go.
That's
but
crazy.
They're setting themselves up for real success here.
I know, but it's crazy to have that good of an average already. And just knowing it's like 2-1, 2-1-1 or something is just...
Well, listen,
they're my picks, but don't beat my record.
They're not. Listen, I'm very confident that they will not beat our record.
They can't get ninth on any leg. Like, they can't.
Right, they can't get ninth, but I just think that I don't see...
You don't see them staying in the top three?
No, I don't see Kurt and Brody, like, falling off like Team Texas fell off. And I see a lot of other teams getting stronger.
They just have to maintain where they are.
I understand. I see a lot of other teams getting stronger. So I think there's a possibility for a couple legs for them to slip back. I definitely see them in the final three.
I mean...
All right, so...
I'm okay, they're my picks.
Next week, what's going on?
Can we just say for draft picks, though? Like, I have all three. Kurt Brody, Tyler Corey, Scott and Blair. You have Bernie and Ashley still, Sherry and Cole, and Justin, you have Dana and Matt, and Zach and Rachel. So I'm beating you both. We should have negotiated, like, a prize for
the
winner.
We didn't. Sorry, but...
Okay. It'll be bragging rights.
It'll be bragging rights. No, I really appreciate each and everybody who's here, everybody who stopped by in the chat room.
Tyler Oakley and a lot of other people were asking about my seal clap. I mentioned it briefly earlier, but let me like remind everyone officially my seal clap was to Sherry when she was on her roadblock and she was like trying to take off in the air and her little legs just kept on kicking. Like that made me so happy.
I saw that. She was like a little kid that can't reach on a seat.
Yes. And if you didn't see the Superfan Award, Sherry also got the Superfan Award for two things. One, showing how to overcome your fear by going and getting the clue when Cole couldn't. And then two, talking Cole into overcoming his fears to do the task that she knew was better. So she definitely deserves the Superfan and the Supermom Award on this episode. So, and in honor of that, on April 3rd, she will be joining us as well. Sherry, I'm very excited to talk to you.
I can't wait to have like another Southern accent on this show.
Me too.
Me too.
Okay, so we are going to Shanghai next week.
Maybe.
Maybe if we can get our visas. If not, then we'll be here. But so do we want to do a show?
Let's ask them if they want us to come.
Chat room. Do you want us to have maybe a guest, a season 28 guest?
Or maybe
on,
we could
or...
do like a Q&A. So like
it would be
couple.
Like. So what it would be me and James Zorro saying and a guest?
No, I would do it Friday when the race was supposed to be on, maybe Friday night at 8.
Oh, that'd be cool.
If the race is not on, maybe we'll have a bunch of season 28s. If anybody from season 28 wants to join us next week,
okay,
we'd love
everyone
to have
in
you.
The chat room saying yes, 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 yes. So let's do it, and someone wants to come on.
Is everybody available Friday? Friday at 8?
Yeah, they'd be watching
Friday
the
night.
Are you guys available Friday at 8? Just want to make sure.
Oh, I should be.
You're a doctor, so I
That's
can't...
That's amazing race time, so of course I'm ready.
All right, so Friday, the next one is going to be a Friday at 8. I'm going to try to book some special guests. If any of you guys want to reach out to me, you know my social media. Maybe we'll get some past get racers from other seasons.
Ooh.
And have like a big kind of Q&A of past racers, current racers. I think it'll be fun.
Let's see who we could get.
Maybe each of us will bring a guest.
Yeah, let's make it a surprise.
Mainly because we don't know right now.
Yeah. That's...
But two, how about each of us find a guest?
Okay.
Pressure is on.
You'll find one for the both of us.
I'll find
right?
one for the both of us. I'll find two.
Sounds good.
All right. I'm sure you guys have plenty of people reaching out to you. So we'll have a bunch of guests Friday, 8 o'clock. Please join us. Thank you.
Thank you for liking, subscribing, and telling your friends about this. We have so much fun doing this, and without that chat room, without you guys watching, there really is no fun for us to do this. We love you. We appreciate you.
Thank you.
Also today, me and... Tiffany and I have been doing master classes. We've been teaching other women, trying to inspire other women to dance, and we've had such a great turnout. So we just released our second video today. It's on my Facebook and my Twitter, and I know so many of you guys have big social media accounts, so if you could please, please help us share it and support us, it would mean everything to us, and you could find the link. I don't know if Justin put it in down there, and it's on my Facebook and my Twitter, so I hope you guys enjoy it and check it out, and, you know, we're one day we'll be like Dana and Matt, but...
One question. What's up with all the flannel shirts tied by around the waist? What's going on with that? You know, guys like to watch these videos too.
Don't like the flannel shirts? I get it. I don't know. That's like kind of like a new like dance thing. Everybody like when it makes you feel like more hip hoppy. I'll make a note of that.
I didn't know if it was time.
We don't require it. People just wear them.
Oh, there was so many of them. I thought you were like, everybody bring a flannel shirt. That's
no,
why I asked.
No, it's just like a new dance thing now. Everybody's doing it.
Okay. Well, good.
But, yeah, thank you so much if you guys can just support us and share it with me and everything. So.
Absolutely. Yeah, she's not asking you to pay for anything. She's asking you to go and click a thumb up on a video. It's free. It takes two seconds.
Just share it for us. We're not,
Keep it up with Criffany?
Yeah, keep it up with Criffany. Not the Kardashian.
James Earl, do you want to tell them where you're giving out free flu shots or something?
Oh, Jocelyn did it already. You're so cute. Wow.
Adorable. I unfortunately do not have really cool stuff going on social media. I just get to join y'all every week and have the time of my life.
And we really appreciate you making time for us.
I love this every week.
And Diana, C11 Charity Can Challenge. I went to the mailbox and there was nothing in there.
Well, I'm going to post pictures. We're going to start sending some thank you notes out.
Yeah. If you don't know what the C11 Charity Can Challenge is, Diana collects like magnets and travel trinkets, like pens and things like that. She puts them in her classroom. She has a charity can where the kids can donate money, any kind of money that they want on their own.
It goes to the Rose of Charity Orphanage that we visited in our season, and then they can pick something off the board. And we have like a big map, and we've been pinning all the places that people send us things from, so the kids are really excited about it. I'm going to take some more pictures, upload them to the Facebook, and start sending out some more thank you notes. So those of you that did donate magnets, you'll get your thank you notes soon.
Love you guys.
Good night.
Bye. James Earl. Bye.